¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes. Les damos la bienvenida a esta segunda ponencia del día de hoy, la cual les recordamos será transmitida a través de las plataformas de YouTube y Neurosurgical TV en inglés y en nuestra página de Facebook con la interpretación en tiempo real en español. El día de hoy nos acompaña, tenemos el honor de tener al doctor Nasser EI-Ghandour. Él es profesor de neurocirugía en la Facultad de Medicina del Cairo en Egipto, presidente de la Sociedad de Cirugía Neurológica en Egipto, secretario general de la Asociación Continental de Sociedades Neurológicas Africanas. El doctor lleva más de 30 años como neurocirujano con alta especialidad en endoscopía ventricular intracraneal, enquistes ventriculares e hidrocefalias complejas. Además, el doctor ha publicado múltiples artículos en revistas de alto impacto en temas de neurocirugía pediátrica, de columna, de base de cráneo y en educación en neurocirugía.
Okay, hello everyone. Good to have you here with us today. It is our second day of the Congress, World Congress of in cooperation with UNESCO, Walter Dandy, Brain Mapping Society, and of course, American Association of Neurological Students, the chapter in Mexico. Today it is this fourth guest in our Congress. So Vice Chairman of our Congress, Dr. Salim Abdulrauf, President of Walter Dandy Neurosurgical Society and Chairman of Abdulrauf Institute, will present our new speaker. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Thank you, Natalie. Thank you, Ermo. It is my pleasure to introduce our next speaker. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Nasser EI-Ghandour. He is a professor of neurosurgery from Cairo University in Egypt. He is the president of the Egyptian Society of Neurological Surgeons, and he is the editor-in-chief of the Pan-Arab Neurosurgery, which is a journal for the Arab world. We're honored to have him with us today. You know, he has played multiple roles in his auspicious career as in leadership in education, in Egypt and in Africa, and he's a second vice president of the World Federation of Neurological Surgeons. So it's great to have you, Professor EI-Ghandour, with us today. Please proceed.
Thank you very much, Professor Salim Abdulrauf. I'm really honored.
Don't hear.
Doctor, I think
Professor EI-Ghandour, your audio is off. Can you start again, please? We can't hear you. If you can turn back your audio.
Okay. Now it's good?
Yeah, please start from the beginning. Please start from the beginning.
Okay.
We didn't hear you.
Okay. I think I have to go out from the
Yeah, we can hear
show.
You now. Yeah.
And now start again.
Yes, Professor. Thank you.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Salim Abdulrauf for this kind introduction. I would like also to thank the organizers of this very important meeting, the UNESCO and International Foundation of Neuroscience, and happy to be one of the speakers in this important neuroscience event. My talk today will be about the neurosurgical education and the impact of COVID-19. And so it's going to be two components, the first part or two parts about the neurosurgical education, and the second part will be about the impact or the effect of COVID-19 on neurosurgical education. Let's first start by the history of neurosurgery and the role of Egypt and the Middle East. Let's go back to the history. This is Edwin Smith papyrus, which is the oldest well-known surgical experience. It was discovered in 1862, and it goes back to the 27th century before Christ. As you all know, the first trephination or trephine operation was performed in Egypt 3,000 years BC. And so Egypt has a very important role in neurosurgery. Look at this important photo. All the Egyptian pharaohs were believing that the soul will return back again after death. And that's why they started the process of mummification, and they used to evacuate the brain through the nostril. and this was the beginning of the transsphenoidal approach. Then another important scientist, Abul Qasim Al-Zawahiri, is an Arab Andalusian physician. He was living in Cordoba in Spain. He described several aspects of neurosurgical pathology and instruments thousands of years later on. Look at this map, at this region, Africa and the Middle East. Neurosurgery began here between the 9th and 13th centuries. And from Africa and the Middle East, the neurosurgical knowledge diffused to Europe, Asia, and the United States. The objective of all our organizations is that we are eager to provide the best quality of health care to all our patients. And that's our main target of all organizations. When we speak about neurosurgery in Egypt, it was very old history, which started 1949, the first neurosurgical practice. And Cairo University was the first unit to be constructed 1952, and then followed by Alexandria University 1956. Our organization, the Egyptian Society of Neurological Surgeons, had been founded in 1967, and 12 years later on, it joined the World Federation of the Neurosurgical Societies. And so it was founded just 12 years after the foundation of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. Let me show you a very interesting video about.
Is there audio with this video, Professor? Dr. Nasser, is there audio with this video?
Is working?
No, it's not working. Please start again. Then start, I think the volume button on the right, maybe it's slow. So if you could start from the beginning.
I will go back again. I need to put the audio on for the video. It is. Professor Salim, where is that to put the audio?
When you are playing it all the way to the right, there is a microphone sign. When you're playing it.
Yes.
Go ahead and play it again.
I'm playing now.
All the way to the right. Yeah, keep going more right there. Yeah, it's all the way to the top. Okay, we're not hearing the audio for some reason.
Can you hear now?
No, we're not hearing anything.
Yes, but it's working.
Okay. The video is working, but we don't hear
and the audio is working too. I don't know why you couldn't hear. And so if you couldn't hear, we can skip the video because I'm trying, but I couldn't solve the problem.
That's okay, we can watch the video.
Let me try again.
Yeah.
Yes. Let me try again. Now it's, you can hear it?
No, we don't hear audio in the video. But you can narrate for us, Professor.
Okay. This is what we were saying, that Egyptians were believing in return of the soul after death. They started the transsphenoid operation during mummification. this papyrus documented 27 cases of head injuries. That's another papyrus. It documented 2 cases of intracranial meningiomas.
Professor, can you try without using the headphones? If you unplug the earpiece, I think the volume, the audio can come through. Do you have to use the earpiece, or can you use the earpiece of the computer?
No, I can remove the earphones.
Yeah, remove it and unplug it from the computer. I wonder if that's what's causing the problem here.
Okay, now
maybe
we try again.
When you put share, the options of sharing, it appears to share with audio.
Yeah, no, we can hear it now.
Can you hear all the video?
Yes.
Thousands of years ago. The modern history of neurosurgery in Egypt had begun in 1949.
Can you hear the video?
Yes.
Neurosurgical practice was performed by Dr.
I will start again.
The Egyptian
just 2 minutes.
Society of Neurological Surgeons, ESNS. Egypt. In this country, life started thousands of years ago. Egyptians are proud that their grandfathers were leaders of the world in all specialties: arts, agriculture, engineering, science, and medicine. Ancient Egyptians believed that in afterlife, the soul would return to the human body to take its place in the eternal kingdom of Amun-Ra. This belief led to advancement of embalming techniques and preservation of the human body. Preservation of the face was quite important, and the technique of removing the brain through the nostril led to the early development of the transsphenoidal technique. The Edwin Smith papyrus was discovered in 1862, and it was attributed to Imhotep. This papyrus is the world's oldest well-known surgical experience. It documented 27 cases of head injuries and 6 cases of spinal injuries. Another papyrus, Eber's papyrus, dating back to 1550 before Christ, it documented 2 cases of intracranial meningiomas found in ancient Egyptian skulls. The first trephine operation was performed in Egypt by Egyptian pharaohs under local anesthesia. This was evidenced by the discovery of healed wounds in skulls unearthed from tombs dating back 6,000 years. Another document had been found showing evidence that King Akhenaten IV was suffering from hydrocephalus, and he wore a helmet to hide his malady. Look at this very old painting. It shows an Egyptian surgeon performing a cranial surgery thousands of years ago. The modern history of neurosurgery in Egypt had begun in 1949. Whereas, the first neurosurgical practice was performed by Dr. Ahmed Abu Zikri, a general surgeon who studied neurosurgery at Mayo Clinic. He performed several neurosurgical procedures. However, he chose to continue as a general surgeon in Cairo University and encouraged his resident, Dr. Osman Surur, to be specialized in neurosurgery. The Egyptian Society of Neurological Surgeons, ESNS, had been founded 50 years ago during a meeting at Al Ma'adi Military Hospital held in 1967. Professor Samuel Bokhtar was appointed the president, Professor Osman Surur the secretary, and Professor Said El-Gindi the treasurer. They were joined by 7 qualified neurosurgeons and 30 trainees. At that time, neurosurgery was not considered a promising career course, but they nevertheless chose to pursue it. This memorial photo shows some Egyptian and European neurosurgeons and their wives during the first European Pan-Arab neurosurgical course, Cairo, 1979. Over the past 50 years, the leaders of our neurosurgical society had made a great effort to make it successful, and this puts a great responsibility over the shoulders of the current members to do their best in order to maintain and increase this success. Completing the journey of the former officers, the new team, including the President, Professor Dr. Nasser EI-Ghandour, General Secretary Professor Dr. Khaled Al-Bahi, and all the board members are working hard, not saving an effort, to push the society forward. A lot of requirements had been fulfilled, including database for about 800 members, bank account, and headquarters. Rich scientific activities had been noticed, including meetings, courses, and workshops in all neurosurgical subspecialties. By the help of our highly qualified IT members, we have a new advanced website for the society. The Egyptian Society of Neurological Surgeons is the first society in Egypt that introduced the e-hotline service, which is the fastest and most recent way of communication between all members. Egyptian neurosurgeons are honored to be affiliated to this ancient society, and they are working hard in order to recall attainments of their grandfathers.
Hello, thank you for watching this documentary. Can you hear my voice?
Yes, we can.
Now, neurosurgical practice, we have four types university hospitals. This is our free healthcare service and teaching medical students at the same time. Ministry of Health hospitals, military hospitals, and private hospitals. There are four types of hospitals in Egypt. We have two types of neurosurgical certifications, the MD or degree of doctor. It's awarded by the Egyptian universities through a training program, extends from 6 to 8 years. The other type of certification is the fellowship of neurosurgery, which is awarded by the Ministry of Health through a training program extending from 7 to 9 years. We go back to the quotation taken from publication of one of the Egyptian leaders in neurosurgery, Professor Said Al-Gindi, published in Neurosurgery 2020, becoming a neurosurgeon in Egypt is a long, arduous process. And then we have another important publication of Peter Black in the World Neurosurgery 2010. This article is very important because in this article, a grading system, scoring system was established in order to evaluate the training programs and certification globally. And he was focusing in Africa and the Middle East. It was published in the World Neurosurgery. It's very important to have a standard or structured grading system because it helps to compare process of certification worldwide. It helps to identify aspects for further improvement, and it creates a common platform for accreditation. In this article, a questionnaire consisting of 13 questions was disseminated among different countries. In Africa, they got response from these societies and from the Middle East. This grading system depends on regional complexity scores, which is two components. The first component is the regional complexity scores organizational, and it's designed mainly to assess the eligibility requirements or the prerequisites to access certification, and it's from 20 points. The second component is the regional complexity scores complexity. And this is designed to assess the complexity of the examination process. And it's also from 20 points. And the final result will be from 40 points. And it's called the regional complexity scores global, the RGSG. And this organization, the first component, it consists of five categories, which are CSO. And these five categories are the written board prerequisites, oral board prerequisites, level of training required, the experience of the board members or the examiners, and the obligatory nature of the examination, either obligatory or it is not obligatory, the questions. The RCSC, this score consists of six categories: multiple choice component, oral examination, surgery evaluation, ESI written component, and OSCE component, and imaging component, what we are it's concerned about radiological imaging. This table shows the two components of this grading system, which is very important in order to evaluate the training programs in different countries. Let's now have a look for the results that the highest score was achieved in South Korea, 21 out of 40. This was followed by the conjoint examination in Singapore and Hong Kong, 20 out of 40, and the United States and Brazil, 20-40. And the highest in Europe was UK, 19 out of 40. Japan, 17 out points out of 40 points. What about Africa and the Middle East? The highest score was found in South Africa, 19 out of 40, whereas in Egypt, it was 18 out of 40 points. This shows the points in the different African countries. And this shows in comparison to other countries that the United States 20, Malaysia was the highest score, 21 out of 40, and South Korea. Both are training programs. They got the highest scores among other countries, depending on this grading or ranking scoring system, which was established by these authors. What about neurosurgical education in Egypt? We have annual Egyptian Congress every year and another two interim meetings, one in the summer, one in winter. And each university or neurosurgical center, they are organizing a meeting or one of the courses each year. And so practically each month we have one or two neurosurgical events. This is a gathering photo in our World Federation Neurosurgical course about neuroendoscopy in Egypt. And these are the trainees and faculty gathering around the president of the WFNS and myself. And this is another training course in Egypt. We are offering scholarships and we are welcoming trainees from developing countries and from Africa to join our hands-on workshops in Egypt. We have different hands-on workshops all over the year in different subspecialties. What about neurosurgery in Africa? Definitely, there are a lot of challenges. Look at these numbers. You can imagine that one neurosurgeon is serving about 1 million population, and there is an unbalanced distribution in Africa. This is a bipolar distribution because when you go to the north and south, you find the ratio one neurosurgeon serving 300,000 population, whereas in other regions like the East, West, and Central, one neurosurgeon is serving more than 2 million population. Again, there is unbalanced distribution in each country where our most neurosurgeons are concentrated in urban countries more than rural countries. Another challenge is that we have the problem of rapidly increasing population, which is more than any other continent. This should be accompanied by increase in the number of neurosurgeons, and this puts an extra burden on the training process and education process. Also, it's expected to find an increase in the pediatric age group and increase in congenital anomalies and head injuries. And how to try to solve this problem? We have to think among the short term, Africa has a deficit of more than 800 8,500 surgeons, neurosurgeons, and obviously this deficit will not be filled in the near future. So education of non-neurosurgeons is very important, like pediatric surgeons and general surgeons, in order to perform life-saving and minor neurosurgical procedures, whereas qualified neurosurgeons become dedicated to perform complex neurosurgical procedures. And among the long term, we have to work very hard in order to increase the number of neurosurgeons and to develop training programs in sub-Saharan Africa. And this goes hand to hand with obtaining the needed equipment. Another important obstacle is the lack of resources. Many countries, especially in the sub-Saharan Africa, they don't have the basic equipment. And that's one of the main obstacles against the development of neurosurgery in sub-Saharan Africa. I will go very fast for the sake of time. Another problem is the problem of training. For years, candidates from Africa were going to be trained in the United States and Europe. And unfortunately, after doing a lot of effort to train these candidates, most of them, they don't come back home again. And the minority of them, when they come back home, they face the problem of maladaptation. And so it's very important to develop training centers in North Africa, in South Africa, and this will take the role of training other regions like sub-Saharan Africa. And this is very important. The collaboration between the different regions in Africa is very important. When you find neurosurgery advanced in the north and the south, and it's not advanced in the sub-Saharan Africa, if there is a sort of integration, this will be a very important solution. Look at this, another problem, lack of governmental awareness. Neurosurgery is considered to be a luxury in many African countries and in the Middle East, and that is the role of organizations to highlight the significance of neurosurgery to governments. And it's very important to have collaboration with vital components like the G4 Alliance and the WHO Liaison Committee and with other specialties as well. Another very important obstacle is the lack of communication. There is not any accurate information about the number of neurosurgeons or member societies. There is problem in communication. That's why I was working hard as General Secretary of the Continental Association of African Neurosurgical Societies. And I developed a very important communication system, which is the e-hotline service. When you put 2013.tel in the browser, in a few seconds, you are going to be transferred inside our organization, be able to find a homepage. Inside this homepage, a lot of icons concerning everything, database, member societies, our Congress, YouTube channel, everything. That is the fastest way of communication existing worldwide. And I'm proud that I introduced this service for KENS and for the Egyptian society. 2013 refers to the year at which the KENS was created. And so, as we said before, there should be a sort of integration between the different societies. That is the 2013 outline. This is the homepage and the group of icons existing. And it's very important to introduce this service because it's easier than the website. But that's not a website, because as you can see here, the website is one of the icons. You can click on this icon and it can open the website for you. That's another video. Thank you. Thank you. I advise everyone to try to put 2013 in the browser of the smartphone or in the browser of the laptop, or put 1967.tel, that's the e-hotline of the Egyptian society. You are going to find something very advanced. And this, I always believe the IT is very important for the advancement of organizations. We published our results in the Neurosurgical Focus, March 2020. And conclusions, neurosurgical education in Africa is far from adequate for many reasons and obstacles, as I just said. There is definite functional polarity, whereas the North and South more developed regarding the number of neurosurgeons and neurosurgical capacity. Egypt is well developed in neurosurgery regarding equipment and programs. Egyptian neurosurgeons constitute 1/3 African neurosurgeons. There is definite problem in communication and for proper collaboration between the different regions regarding education, it's very important and it will enhance the African neurosurgery and make it an independent specialty. And for this proper collaboration, we need a proper communication system. And this has been already created September 2019. Let us now move to the second part of this presentation, the impact of COVID-19 on neurosurgical education and the beginning of virtual learning. And I'm going to speak globally and in Africa. The coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic has affected all aspects of human existence with social and psychological repercussions that generations have not witnessed before. As the virus is projected to afflict large portions of the world population, clinical research at all levels has been suspended. Clinical articles replaced by reviews and surveys and conferences have migrated from classroom to the digital screen. With the eruption of this new method of neurosurgical education, many questions arise, and we should go inside the minds of our colleagues in neurosurgeons worldwide, and we should try to know how they think. That's why we have many questions and we need to answer these questions. Is virtual learning effective as in-person meetings? What are its limitations? Is it possible to develop clinical skills through virtual learning? What about the opinion of neurosurgeons about this new platform? Is Q&A communication equal to face and face? Is it a turning point in the neurosurgical education? What about the impact of this technology on the on-site meetings? Could virtual learning totally replace in-person meetings in the future? What do you expect about the future of neurosurgical education? In order to answer these questions, we need to survey one globally and one in the African continent. This is one of the very important surveys I did with my team. And this survey was translated into 7 languages. It is a global survey. And it was administered through Google Forms and WeChat, and we used the standard statistical methods. And this is one of the few surveys at which multivariate logistic regression analysis was performed, because we have a very good response. Respondents were about 891, covering 96 countries over the world. 165 out of these respondents, they were from Africa. And we used the World Bank classification in order to classify the countries into different categories, either low income, low and middle income, low upper income, or high income. And this bar graph shows the incidence of participation among the different categories in the survey. Again, we used the World Bank's classification in order to classify the countries according to regions or to geographical location into North America, Latin America, Europe and Central Asia, East Asia and Pacific, South Asia, Middle East and North Africa, and Sub-Saharan Africa. And as you can see in this bar graph, which shows the incidence of participation in the survey among the different categories, that we had the maximum participation from the Middle East and North America and North Africa. This was followed by Europe and Central Asia, followed by Latin America and Caribbean. This shows the incidence of participation in the survey according to practice session. Academic practice constituted the highest level of participation with an incidence of about 48.5%. This shows the incidence of participation according to the specialty. Most of the participants were general neurosurgeons. This shows the incidence of participation, whether faculty or trainees, and you can notice that the difference was not so much big or significant. Trainees constituted 53%, whereas faculty constituted 46% participation. This survey depending mainly on three components: virtual learning before and after COVID-19, opinion about this shift to virtual learning, and what about the future of virtual learning. The first component, comparison between before and after COVID-19, this shows the incidence of participation in the virtual learning or in the webinars before and after COVID. And the blue column that shows that the incidence was 44% before the COVID-19 pandemic, and it became 78%. This shows the incidence of paying fees for virtual learning before and after COVID. 51% of the participants before the pandemic, there was no payment. And after the pandemic, they said that they will not pay. This shows the distribution of the virtual learning according to organizations. The respondents were more participating in the international organizations' webinars more than the national organized webinars. The second component, opinion about the shift to virtual learning. Could virtual learning totally replace on-site meetings? 54.7% of the participants said no. They said it will never replace the on-site meetings. Are you interested to attend virtual learning in the meetings in the future? 74.3% of the respondents said yes, they could attend. Which subspecialties don't benefit from virtual learning? There wasn't any significance between the different neurosurgical subspecialties. And the third component, the future of virtual learning. We expect increased virtual learning in the future. And 69.7% said yes, we are expecting increase in the virtual learning in the future. Can you pay fee for virtual learning in the future? And 64.1% of the respondents said no. We are not ready to pay any fees for the virtual learning webinars. What are the factors that influence the participation in virtual learning? The most common was time flexibility. And that's why it's very important to be well organized. We have now a tsunami of webinars arranged every day and organized every day, different organizations. And there is a significant overlap. And there should be a type of coordination. That's very important. And the second important thing, it depends on the faculty and it depends on the cost. Would virtual learning alter neurosurgical education in the future? 62.4% said yes, it could alter. We were able to do multivariate logistic regression analysis and it showed two significant results. Sub-Saharan Africa said that it can alter, when they were compared to North America, they said that yes, it can alter education and training strategy in the future. And they said that they are willing to pay for virtual learning depending on the content. Again, with my team, after getting the results of this survey, we published these results in the Neurosurgical Focus. And then this is another survey about the impact of COVID-19 in neurosurgical training, but in Africa. This was done by young neurosurgeons, the young African neurosurgeons, and me as the general secretary of this organization. I disseminated the survey into the five African regions, North, South, East, West, Central, through the second vice presidents. Participants were 123, covering 23 countries. This map shows the green color, the countries participating in the survey. The most common participation was from Nigeria, 27 respondents, followed by South Africa and Kenya. And this shows the incidence of previous exposure to COVID-19. 35 of the respondents said that they think they were exposed to COVID-19 during at the emergency department at work. Impact on training, the departmental teaching was canceled in 43.9%. Examination of candidates postponed in 57.7%. Examination was canceled in 19.5%. 11.4% of the trainees were re-employed and trainees were sent home in 3.3%. What about the impact of on income? Fortunately, 84.6% of the respondents said there wasn't any effect on the income. What about the impact on clinical activity? The neurosurgical activity was reduced by an incidence of 91.9% concerning elective surgery and 74.8% concerning emergency surgery, whereas in 61% the clinics were canceled and it was reduced in 45%. Again, we published our results in the World Neurosurgery. And this shows the difference between two surveys. The first survey was global survey and published in the Neurosurgical Focus. And there was 891 respondents, 165 from Africa. The second was Continental African Survey, 123. The first one was concerned mainly about the impact during the pandemic and about the future, and mainly about the virtual learning. The second one was concerned mainly about impact during the pandemic era or a pandemic period only for the concerning the training programs. As a conclusion, COVID-19 is a turning point in the neurosurgical education. COVID-19 is the actual beginning of virtual learning. Virtual learning will not be alternative to real meetings. However, an alternate method of education during which can be used during future crises. Credibility and coordination are very important. Virtual learning is more appropriate for sub-Saharan Africa and for developing countries. The long-term impact of virtual learning on neurosurgical education is still not evident. We need more studies. We need more surveys. It seems that virtual learning and in-person learning soon will be integrated in a new type of meetings, which we call it hybrid meetings. As second vice president of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies, I organized 30 webinars since the beginning of COVID-19 pandemic in collaboration with the Egyptian Society of Neurosurgery and the Continental Association of African Neurosurgical Societies. Our organizations were among the most active ones in arranging these scientific activities. The last activity was an educational symposium last Friday with my friend, Professor Satoshi Kuroda, the chairman of the Education and Training Committee of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. We had about 12 eminent speakers and 3 eminent moderators. And if you ask about my personal opinion about virtual learning, I could say that I can tolerate a webinar for 1 to 2 hours. However, complete scientific event for 2 to 3 days will be exhausting. I can't lean my back each day for 8 hours for 2 or 3 days in a whole scientific meeting. It will be very difficult. And I also believe that social events are a very important part in these meetings for developing and maintaining friendship between all of us, which is a very important atmosphere for the development and advancement of our specialty. Look at this table, which shows the difference between virtual learning and in-person learning. Virtual learning, of course, it's low cost or free in most of the cases. It's money saving, it's life, it's time saving. However, it is it's also more suitable for the sub-Saharan Africa and developing countries. However, it's not the proper way for developing neurosurgical skills. Still, hands-on. Our specialty is, it depends mainly on the skills. It depends on the surgical handcraft. It's not, we are not dermatology, we are not medicine. It's very important to attend hands-on workshops and courses. It's very important to have personal and face-to-face communication. However, new technology, for example, the virtual reality platforms, Operation Room Live series, augmented reality, and simulation labs might change our concept in the future. We don't know what's going to happen in the future. The technology is advanced. It's advancing very, very fast. Again, we have, this is another survey about the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on neurosurgery. This was the first survey to be done worldwide. I'm very honored to do this survey with my team. And we published our results in the neurosurgery. It's very important because we started very early at the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. And this publication also, it gives me pride to be one of the authors of this publication, which honors our brothers and sisters, neurosurgeons, colleagues who lost their lives while fighting against COVID-19. Let me end my talk by sending my prayers to all of them to rest in peace and to be in heaven. I'd like to announce about a very important educational event, World Federation Neurosurgical event next Friday. For the first time, I'm organizing a very important webinar with my friend, Professor Nelson Ayasiko, the president-elect of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. It's going to be about how to promote neurosurgical research and publications. In this session, we will have the editors-in-chief of the top journals of neurosurgery. They are going to answer many questions and try to help our candidates, the young neurosurgeons worldwide, in order to know how to raise the standards and quality of articles submitted to these journals and hence increase the incidence of publication. The flyer and the program of this important scientific activity is already available in the rotating banner of the website of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. It needs registration before the meeting. I advise all the young neurosurgeons to join this important event. This is going to be the last webinar among the series of webinars I organized during the year 2020. I hope for you all my best wishes and to have happy holidays and happy vacations. And my best wishes to all of you that 2021 will be very successful and will be very happy year to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor EI-Ghandour, for that really excellent presentation about you as an educator, really giving us a framework of how we're dealing with this crisis around the world. I also thank you for your presentation about the history of education, especially in the continent of Africa and the challenges that are faced. Your contributions are really tremendous, and we thank you for that. I especially would like to bring up the issue of something you raised, and I have previously written a message as the president of the Dandy Society about the concern we have about the treatment of hydrocephalus in children in sub-Saharan Africa. Some 200,000 children below the age of 2 die every year. And clearly your efforts and the efforts of your colleagues will help us deal with these kind of really critical shortage of neurosurgeons and facilities in the in sub-Saharan Africa. Professor, do you know what's going on with the treatment of people during the COVID crisis in sub-Saharan Africa? Has there been an impact, has been a decrease, especially in the treatment of children in sub-Saharan Africa from a neurosurgical standpoint?
Yes, we have definite problem in sub-Saharan Africa. And I know that many of our colleagues, they are doing much effort in Uganda, and there are a lot of memorandum of understandings between different universities in Europe and the United States and different centers, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. I think in Rwanda, in Uganda, I know them personally and they are doing a very good job, but still there is definite problem. Imagine Professor Salim Abdelraouf, there are about 11 countries in sub-Saharan Africa without a single neurosurgeon. And that's a problem, no single neurosurgeon. And most of the other countries, just 5 or 6 or 7 neurosurgeons, that we have definite problem. And as I said in my presentation, that we have another problem in communication. We don't have accurate database about these people. Definitely there is problem in communication, there is problem in database. That's why I established the hotline and the website of the CANS and trying to solve the problem of communication. I thought I was in San Diego during the last WNS meeting in April 2019, the last meeting. It was done in April 2019, and I was one of the members at the directors of board, and I was representing Africa in that meeting. And I said, I totally believe that Africa as a continent, we can integrate with each other, and we don't need to send for you our people. We need you just to support training centers. We need to do 2 training. As you know, Professor Salim Abdelraouf, in our continent, we have half the countries speaking English, Anglophone countries, half the countries speaking French, Francophone countries. And this is another problem which adds to the division of the neurosurgery in Africa. And so my thinking was to make training center. Already there is training center in Rabat, in Morocco, in North Africa. And but this mainly teaching or educating Francophone countries, because they are speaking French. We need another center to be constructed in Egypt to train people who are speaking English, another center in South Africa. I believe that South Africa and North Africa, if they play an important role in education, they will solve the problem in sub-Saharan Africa. Because when we send our people to your center, for example, Professor Salim, they like to stay forever in the United States. Better salary, better conditions to live, better temptations, everything is much better. And why to come back? And so when you raise your candidate and you spend a lot of expenses and you do a lot of hard work, and after he becomes a board certified, qualified neurosurgeon, he can migrate and practice in a well-developed country. That's type of selfishness. He has to be loyal to his country, he has to try to develop neurosurgery. We need training programs in sub-Saharan Africa. Still, we have problem. We are working very hard. Right now in Egypt, we have 13 candidates from sub-Saharan Africa joining our training programs. We are doing lot of scholarships and lot of courses and hands-on. Professor Salim came to Egypt many times. We did many. He was supporting the workshops about skull base, and these workshops is continuously taking over now every year until Professor Salim started. We have hands-on workshops in all subspecialties. And imagine the amount of hydrocephalus we have in Egypt. The resident in one day is able to watch 100 children with hydrocephalus. We call it hydrocephalus clinic. We have 2 of the biggest pediatric hospitals in Africa and the Middle East, the Japanese hospital, and this is affiliated to Cairo University, and the oncology hospital pediatric, which is 57357. And in the Japanese hospital, the resident can watch 100 children with hydrocephalus. I was speaking with my friend Nelsie Zenon 2 weeks ago. She was an invited speaker in one of my webinars, and she's doing a project about meningocele. I spoke with Diruko and with Professor Shocks. They are doing a project about hydrocephalus. We need to collaborate together. Definitely there is a problem. A lot of people are dying. They couldn't find the proper neurosurgical care in sub-Saharan Africa. In Egypt, as I showed you now, the neurosurgery is very well developed, and Professor Salim knows this. We know how to deal with very difficult and complicated cases, but still we can't do the proper role we're supposed to do in sub-Saharan Africa.
Professor, your wisdom and your thoughts are really, really appreciated. The issue in sub-Saharan Africa is a big concern for us about all these children. And this cannot be just a concern for Africa. It should be a concern for all of us, because these children are dying unneedlessly, lack of simple treatments. The North Star, the solution, are the young African neurosurgeons, this young generation that's coming up. And I believe in them. They come from sub-Saharan countries, and they are dedicated to improving their countries. And we, as African neurosurgeons, and we as international neurosurgeons, we must support the young African neurosurgeons. We should stand with them shoulder to shoulder, because too many children are dying, and this should not be acceptable by any of us wherever in the world we're living. The fact that Egypt, Morocco, and South Africa are very advanced in neurosurgery, that is great, but that is not enough, because we need to see the whole continent, you know, getting that kind of expertise. And as you said, Professor, it's exactly right. We need to have training centers in sub-Saharan Africa. It is very hard for people to travel to other countries and to fly and to go learn things. Ultimately, the answer is that these young generation of neurosurgeons, that they are supported by us, by leaders from around the world, that we let them have the presence in their countries to develop their systems, to work with their governments, to work with their health ministries. As you know, there's so much red tape. And I tried to do so much in sub-Saharan Africa, and I faced a lot of issues. You know, there's a lot of governmental red tape and issues. So we need to make it easy for this young generation. I think that's the answer, Professor. We need to really invest in the young generation of African neurosurgeons. Let them know that we will help them where they live. We will develop, we will come, we will train. I have now, through my initiative, volunteer neurosurgeons, residents, and medical students from all over the world who are willing to come at their own time. So it is time, it's high time for all of us, the various organizations, to come together for our African colleagues and to really make this happen finally, because these kids dying is really, it's a shame for all of us, not just for you in Egypt, it's for all of us. And we have to do a better job. And as a small specialty, we must live up to this this higher call. And it's high time for us to do this. So Professor EI-Ghandour, your leadership in the continent in Africa, what you're doing is exactly what we need. Really, what you have done for your country in Egypt and what you're doing for Africa, it is exactly the kind of leadership that's needed to get to the next step. So we thank you for your tremendous presentation. We thank you for being with us here. Thank you for opening our eyes for some of the challenges that are being faced by neurosurgeons around the world, but specifically in your continent. I think that challenges are even much more difficult. But with time and with the young generation watching us from around the world, I believe many of them will stand shoulder to shoulder with us to help us in the future with this. So we really, really appreciate your contributions, Professor. It's great work. It's great work.
Thank you, Professor Salim. And thank you for always you are cooperating with neurosurgery in Egypt and in Africa and in the Middle East. I know this, Professor Salim, never mind to be invited at any time as guest speaker. He is replying and he is doing his effort to develop neurosurgery. And really, we appreciate this much, especially in the field of skull base. That's very, very important. I'd like to thank you about such efforts, Professor Salim, so much, really.
Thank you, Professor Nasser EI-Ghandour, and I will see you, all of you guys, in about 3 hours. The next generation of neurosurgical advances coming from the next generation and new techniques, and we will discuss that in 3 hours. We again acknowledge Professor Nasser EI-Ghandour and Egyptian neurosurgery for the role they have played in the continent of Africa and for continue to lead. Thank you all of you for being with us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.